Well, hello, everybody. So welcome, and thanks for coming on board for the 10th anniversary of ILCM's office in Worthington. So my name is Matt Intenza. I am a proud graduate of Worthington Senior High School. My wife, Jeannie, who's originally just from up the road in Canby, Minnesota, are thrilled to be a part 10 years ago. Actually, the story goes back 12 years ago to the creation of the Worthington office. Jeannie then was board chair of ILCM, part of her commitment as someone from Greater Minnesota to celebrate the diversity of Minnesota and to make sure we're supporting all of our citizens and residents of the state of Minnesota. And as someone from Worthington, I was really concerned because I saw so many wonderful people in the Worthington area who needed legal services as immigrants, but weren't getting them and couldn't get access to them. And so we sat down with the folks at ILCM, John Keller, who was then the executive director, and had a whole bunch of conversations. And of course, the context over a decade ago was, as many of you know, Worthington had the biggest immigration raid in the history of our country, which was just a horrible, horrible thing, where people's due process was not recognized, where people were scared and not treated well by our federal government, and where people deserve representation and deserve the opportunity to make sure that their voices could be heard. And I'm just so proud to see what's happened over the last 10 years. I see Kathy, who was our first attorney in Worthington, joining us here today, and Kathy's still at ILCM, and just knowing the hundreds and hundreds of people who've been helped. You know, since opening the Worthington office, ILCM has served over 1,400 different cases. They have supported immigrants that have applied for citizenship. I've actually been part of a group of volunteer attorneys at different times. We've gone down to help people to apply for citizenship. Dreamers, as they've applied for, renewed their DACA benefits. And young immigrants who came to Worthington to escape abuse or neglect. ILCM's clients in Southwest Minnesota have come from over 30 different countries, with the majority coming from Latin America and Asia. And additionally, ILCM has built countless relationships with community partners and leaders across the region. And ILCM has had a significant impact on Worthington in this last decade. So I'm really thrilled to celebrate with all of you tonight, knowing that it wasn't just those of us who planted early on, but those of you who've built it, you know, block by block since then, and those of you who are supporting ILCM. This is our chance to celebrate. It's now my pleasure to introduce our moderator for the event, Andrea Duarte Alonso. Andrea is a Lead for America Hometown Fellow with the Southwest Initiative Foundation and the Immigrant Law Center in Worthington. And I am particularly proud that Andrea has grown up as I did in Worthington. Worthington, for those of you who don't know, although I suspect most of you do, is one of the most diverse communities in Minnesota. And that makes it a wonderful and beautiful place to live and to visit, and makes me very proud of my hometown. Andrea has documented stories of first and second generation immigrants in Southwest Minnesota through her Stories from Unheard Voices project. And she is a 2019 graduate from St. Catharines University, where she earned her BA degree in political science, in women's studies, and English. And Andrea, thanks for being here to help us moderate. We're proud of you as a Worthingtonian, and we're proud of the work that you and others are doing on behalf of ILCM. So thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Matt. I'm so excited to be here with you all. I now have the privilege of introducing our distinguished panel tonight. Justice Gordon Moore was appointed as an Associate Justice of the Minnesota Supreme Court earlier this year. He was previously a judge of the Minnesota 5th District Court in Nobles County from 2012 to 2020. He is a Minnesota native who moved to Worthington in the mid-1990s to raise a family and build a legal career. Prior to joining the bench, he was an attorney in private practice, an assistant Minnesota Attorney General, an assistant Worthington City Attorney, and the Nobles County Attorney. Our second panelist, Nathalie Nkashama. She is an immigrant social worker and entrepreneur. In 2018, Nathalie and her husband opened World Mart in Worthington to supply many ethnic foods that were missing for new immigrants. faced with the COVID-19 pandemic, WorldMart evolved and became a store on wheels. In addition to building her business and serving Worthington's immigrant communities, Nathalie is also a child protection worker for Nobles County. She holds a degree in psychology from Hamline University. And finally, our last panelist, Joyce Bennett Alvarado. Joyce is a staff attorney in ILCM's Worthington office. She is a dedicated advocate for immigrants and refugees in Southwest Minnesota and has supported clients with navigating the complex processes to secure immigration protection as crime victims, lawful permanent residents, and citizenship. Joyce is a graduate of the University of St. Thomas Law School. Thank you all panelists for being here tonight with us. I hope everyone is on mute. I'm hearing a little background noise. So just a reminder for everyone. Thank you. To begin tonight's conversation, I'll pass the first question to Justice Moore. Justice Moore, many people do not realize that the parties coming before the courts in Nobles County are some of the most diverse in the state, if not the country. Tell us about your experience being a district judge in such a diverse courtroom, and how can our justice system better serve diverse litigants? And what has been the role of organizations like ILCM?
Well, first of all, Andrea, I'd like to thank you and the Immigrant Law Center, Vina, Matt, and all the members of the panel for inviting me to be part of this. I spent 25 and a half proud years in Worthington, and 8.5 of those years I did spend on the bench in Nobles County. And it was really, I think I've said this before, but it's true. It was a transformative experience for me. And it was transformative because of the interactions that I had with the diversity that you've referenced in Worthington. It was not uncommon for me to have foreign languages, 18 to 20 of them a year, requiring an interpreter in my courtroom. It required me to become much more culturally sensitive and aware. And the stories that I heard in my courtroom, I'll never forget. And the Immigrant Law Center, I saw being a huge contributor to access to justice in Nobles County. We would have people coming into court, or when I was county attorney, I would see them coming into court. And you know, they needed legal advice. They needed immigration advice. They needed all sorts of different assistance. And there was the legal aid office was doing the best it could with the resources that it had, but its priorities were mostly in housing and in family law. And immigration is a real unique subspecialty, as many on this call are well aware. And the Immigrant Law Center came in to Worthington, as Matt indicated, after a really, really hard time for the community. And the Immigrant Law Center has built something that has thrived. It's spawned a lawyer in private practice in Worthington that's doing immigration law. It's sent people to other offices. And, you know, thanks to the Immigrant Law Center and the work that I did in the district court, I've had the, you know, honor of a lifetime and being able to move on to a different job at the state level. But I bring to that the experience I had with immigrants in district court, and in particular, the experience that I had with the unaccompanied minors, with children and child protection. I would say those are two areas that I really, really will never forget. And, you know, it was really humbling to have conversations with these young unaccompanied minors who would tell me about their stories. And I wanted to hear their stories about where they had come from, how they'd gotten to Worthington, what obstacles they'd overcome. And, you know, it was inevitable that I'd walk back to chambers with my court staff, and you just feel for a moment like, you know, how blessed you were, how much privilege you had, frankly, to be living in a community like Worthington and a place like Minnesota that supports these types of endeavors. The Immigrant Law Center has been an important part of helping to level the playing field for clients, for people who need resources. It's been a resource, I know, for the County Family Services Agency and the Law Enforcement Agency to give people an avenue to find legal counsel, to make appropriate arguments for immigration. Obviously, the state court that I was involved with had, you know, no direct connection with the immigration courts in mostly in Minnesota and Bloomington. But sometimes the things that we did in state court would have an effect on the immigrant's ability to make certain arguments in federal court. And so I felt like in a small way, although I wasn't an immigration judge, I certainly became much more aware of immigration issues. And, you know, I know that's continuing from what I've heard from my former staff in Worthington.
Thank you, Justice Moore. That's a really good perspective to put out there. And with someone who works, you know, closely, Joyce, as someone obviously who works with immigrant and refugee families in Southwest Minnesota, can you tell us what your legal experience has been like working with diverse clients before the pandemic and during? Any similarities and differences show up? And how has ILCM responded to the unique needs posed by the pandemic?
Yeah, absolutely. During the time I've spent working here at ILCM, I've had the opportunity to work with people from very diverse cultural and ethnic backgrounds. So that definitely helps you grow as a lawyer and have, you have to learn how to be more sensitive, how to be more patient, but it also helps you have different perspectives and to identify issues faster. Sometimes things that are normal here in the US are not so normal to people who come from a different part of the world and vice versa. So you learn how to, you know, talk to people in a different way depending on their culture or their religion. And that is something that working for ILCM has taught me, definitely. A part of what we do at ILCM is the outreach component as well. So we try to engage with the community by teaching them and about their rights, about immigration, current immigration topics when needed. We try to collaborate with agencies to try to help them and guide them to know how to better serve immigrant families and refugee families. So we try to collaborate with other agencies when they need education on topics like SIJS or U visas. We try to engage in that. Definitely the pandemic has affected our ability to do that outreach. And also because ILCM has been in town for a long time, people and our clients feel like ILCM is like a very reliable source of information. So they feel okay, and they feel very free to come and stop by our office when they have any questions, even if it's not immigration related. So it's not uncommon that clients will show up at my office with a letter from another agency asking me to read it for them or explain what they have to do, where they have to go, who to have to call. And the pandemic has affected my capacity to do that, even though we're still open for business and we're trying to work as normal as possible as we possibly can. We're working through email, through phone, through video conferences, but that part was taken away from them because of the pandemic. We're trying to safeguard everyone's safety and their health, but we're still working with people. The pandemic brought challenges on its own. For example, at the early stages when people were afraid to go back to their jobs because of the outbreak we had in town, clients came to me with concerns, and I refer them to the appropriate people to file OSHA complaints if they felt it was necessary, or we had worksheets for people who wanted to apply for unemployment benefits, whether they were eligible or not, and advocacy with employers because of the delays that the pandemic brought with processing times and applications with immigration. So I had to do a lot of back and forth with employers to explain what was going on, if they were getting their cards later, things of that sort. And I feel like my clients are facing most of the same issues that they've been facing, issues with employment, with housing. Locally at Worthington, we've had the opportunity to be part, well, the community has provided like food pantries and COVID relief funds for immigrant families. I've helped a couple of clients apply for those funds. And I think ILCM, even though we are just a legal service provider, we try to be open to our clients' concerns, even if we don't provide that service, that we have enough sources on our websites and social media so people know where to go if we can't provide that service. So I think that's to the best of our ability, we've tried to help people support our clients during the pandemic.
Yeah, that sounds like a lot, Joyce, but very important work. Thanks for all that you do with ILCM. And Nathalie, you also work with immigrants, perhaps not on a very immigration legal services side, but with your entrepreneurship. Can you tell us more about WorldMart, how it became started, and what you've learned so far from either your clients, the community members, or of owning a small business geared for immigrants in Worthington?
Yes, thank you so much. I thank God for the opportunity to speak at this panel, and thank you to ILCM and Andrea, and also all the panelists here. And I'm glad that I'm here to share, and I hope to learn more again. Opening WorldMart has been a blessing. I always believe that in life, everyone has something to offer and learn. And my children inspired me to start this business. My son wanted, to sell, some toys and all that. And I told him I'll help him get a license, which I didn't even know how and where to start from. But then I delayed the process because I'm busy with my job as a, child protection social worker. So he came one day with a book from the school library, how to turn $100 into $1 million. And he said, "Mom, see, I read this book. You should have let me do my toys and sell my toys. you couldn't start." I mean, he said that I was not going to do it, the business. And that was a challenge for me to do it, to show him that it's possible, he can do it. And then we had to sit and think about which ways we can go about what was needed in the community. So I involved them in the conversation. They told me what they wanted, and we looked at what was needed at the moment. We needed to bridge the gap. And bridging the gap was cultural food for African, African immigrant in Worthington. There were different types of grocery stores, like Hispanic and Asian, the ones that could meet the need of the community, but not the Africans. So that's how I decided to start WorldMart. Now that journey has been so beautiful because it's not just about selling food; it's bridging the gap. I build bridges in the community with food, sometimes hairstyle. If you see me in different time, I'll have short hair. I wear different style. It's bridging the gap. With whatever I have, I bridge the gap, like food, resources. I found myself again also filling out paperwork outside of my job duty. Someone will come and say, they come to buy food and then they bring me paperwork. I didn't understand this. Then I bridge them to the proper channel, because if there's someone who can do that, the resources at the county that can do that, I redirect them to that resource, for instance. There are family challenges that, I've bridged the gap in many ways. So it's a different type of business that sometimes don't take money, but mostly bridge the gap in different ways, many ways that I can't even list here. So having this business has taught me that we need to embrace, because I am selling food that is not from my culture. It's not from my culture. I'm not Ethiopians. Majority of African immigrants here are Ethiopians. Then you have South Sudanese and also Liberian. Then the rest are really not so many. I had to sell what was not part of my culture's food. And it was also a challenge to do that, because you're doing something that is not part of your culture. I had to be embraced. But in order to embrace, you have to learn to make a path to go towards others. And immigrants add value. They add value to the community. Worthington is beautiful because of the immigrants that are here. It's a different experience. It's a world in America. If someone has not really traveled around the world, just come to Worthington. They should come to Worthington, and you go from one end to the other, you see different people, and it's just beautiful. What led me here is a blessing through Nobles County. I was hired in the position that allowed me to move here. I'd never heard anything about Worthington. I didn't know where is Worthington, what is Worthington. My mom didn't bring me here. My dad didn't bring me here. Nobody brought me here but a job. I was given an opportunity. As an immigrant, you hear a lot of immigrants fear because this barrier, you know, in certain position or employment. I want to be the bridge that hope for somebody that it is possible. With Walmart, that's what I do. I communicate that message. It is possible. Nobody, not, my mom didn't bring me here. I didn't have someone who referred me to Nobles County. It is possible. Just keep dreaming, keep working hard, keep pushing. That's what I want to inspire somebody. It is possible for everyone. And it's okay to embrace other cultures. How did I make people actually embrace me from another culture, also who are Africans? There's an African saying that says, a man's way, it says actually a way to a man's heart is through his stomach. Okay? There's nothing like food that unite people. And I was able to win the people's heart through food, and through food, I found another way. And with Walmart and my position, I've been able to bridge, like to network. When I moved here, I wanted to know this community really well. I met with people, greet people, get to know who's my neighbor, who's next, who's here, who are the key people here. So I networked with, I started networking from the city administration to the community leaders, and then the people of the country. So Walmart has been able to bridge the gap for the people here.
Thank you. That's great. And I really enjoyed the fact that you emphasized so much on community building, relationship building, and just the fact that we have so many diverse immigrants, not just one country, not just one continent, but truly the whole globe here. And that just leads me actually to the next question. This question is for everyone. So what are some of the unique needs of immigrants and refugees living in Southwest Minnesota? And what are the best ways to address those needs? For example, Nobles County has a second largest number of unaccompanied minors per capita in the nation. How can we better support these young people? And we'll go again back. Nathalie, can you start with us? And then Justice Moore and Joyce.
Can you repeat that again, Andrea?
Of course. What are some of the unique needs of immigrants and refugees living in Southwest Minnesota? And what are the best ways to address those needs?
Yes. And how there are different ways to address the needs that we have here. Working with families through my business has led me to understand certain needs, and meeting with people. We have a lot of young people coming here, unaccompanied minor in Nobles County. And a lot of immigrants that come to work through JBS, which is the biggest, at least, I don't know the statistics, but they are among the biggest employers here in Worthington. You can correct me on that, Andrea or the team. So they come here with sometimes no knowledge of the culture, the laws of the land, like physical punishment, what is wrong, what is right, those type of things, for instance. So I believe the way to help immigrants that come here that learn is to have a place where they can, a resource center where they can come and get all this information, how to go to the immigration law center, how to go to the county services, how to navigate those services, where to go, what are the laws of the key laws of the land, what are their rights as citizens, at least the 10 amendments. How do they know it? Of course, most people learn through going through citizenship, but not everybody goes through citizenship path. So the people have to learn. If we have that, that will make a difference. And also the Dreamers Act, like helping those young people who come here to access education. It's very important. They are added value. They learn in America, from America, from Americans, and it's important that they give back what they've received. That's where I always say, everyone has something to offer and learn. So they learn and they can offer back to the society. And I hope that the work of the ICE, the Immigration Law Center, really bridge that gap in continuing what has started to help these young people make this their home. Those are some of the challenges that I found in Minnesota and especially in Worthington.
Thank you, Nathalie. Justice Moore?
Andrea, my observation on this question would be education is the key. The kids and the families that I saw in court, I saw some just heroic things done by parents and by families to try to help their children have a better life and get education. And the unaccompanied minors that I had in my courtroom, I never had any of those kids and any other type of juvenile delinquency problems or anything like that, because these kids understood the opportunity that they might be able to have if they could demonstrate that they were in school and they were learning and they were heading on to something bigger. And the Worthington School District deserves commendation for the efforts that it has made to accommodate the growth of immigrants in Worthington over the last 25 to 30 years. The languages are many, the challenges are there, but they day by day educate kids. They you know, some days the numbers are up, some days they're down, but they're there to educate, and they do. And kids from Worthington go off in the world with the advantage of having an exposure to cultures and to languages and to people other than themselves. There's a young man from Worthington that was accepted at University of California, Berkeley, this year. I mean, that just shows you he's the child of an immigrant family. The opportunities that exist for young people in this world that are bilingual, trilingual in some cases, and are educated, the sky's the limit. And, you know, these, I would see time and time again, these parents would get it. Some parents from places in the world where, you know, they would tell me they never had the chance to get any education. In Guatemala, if you're not a, you know, prominent family, if you're not wealthy, the government's not going to send you to school. You're faring for yourself. And, you know, these young children getting the ability to learn, the ability to be a productive, taxpaying member of our society is so important. And so I think the way to improve the lives of immigrants in the future is for the children of today to get as much education as possible, to learn, to retain the language of their families. I always stress that, but to learn English, to learn as much as they could about everything and go out into the world and you know, show us what you can do. And there are a lot of stories of young people from Worthington that have done extremely well in much bigger ponds of universities, colleges, and I really stressed that all the time when I was on the bench. I think that's the key.
Thank you, Justice Moore.
Andrea, I would like to add one more thing here, if you don't mind. Yes, so also having people who are in the land, how do you to embrace and welcome others? I've had a chance to have great supervisors, and let me say that. As an immigrant, to have great supervisors who were very supportive in the cities and here, it makes a big difference for an immigrant, because sometimes you feel like you're the only person in the room, like me, only person of color, a Black person in the team. So it makes a big difference. Language is not a barrier. You know, people should see that language is not a barrier. It's actually rich language is rich, because I'm able to communicate with other people who are in need, the newcomers, for instance, and we should embrace everyone. Equality in opportunities, like job opportunities, is very important, and equality in terms of getting loan for businesses. I have been blessed to work with different organizations here that were able to give grants to small businesses and teach businesses to immigrant as well. So it's very important to have those services in place, and I'm thankful for that.
I agree with you, Nathalie. Thank you for adding all that. Joyce.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with both Justice Moore and Nathalie. Education is crucial, especially when it comes to SIJS. Many people are not aware of the existence of this immigration relief. I've had clients, and we've seen clients that are ideal or were ideal candidates for this program, but they did not apply because they were not aware of its existence. So it is important that we keep on letting people know of SIJS, that we contribute and we collaborate with agencies that help and work with immigrant youth and children so they can refer them to immigration attorneys when needed, and that they help identify, and they have systems that help identify particular needs that immigrant children have that maybe US born kids do not. So that's really important. I think that transportation is a big issue here in Southwest Minnesota. In Worthington, we are lucky enough to have a grocery store in town and many resources, but people from neighboring towns that are smaller have to travel, and some undocumented immigrants don't have access to have a license. It is important to have a car to move around in Worthington and neighboring areas. So these immigrants end up paying hundreds of dollars for a trip to Sioux Falls, for example, for a medical appointment or an appointment with immigration, and that is just not fair. So maybe the bill, if that bill could pass, license for all, that would be amazing for our community. That would help our economy as well. I see that housing is a big issue here. It's not uncommon that my clients would come to me because they've been victims of discriminatory practices by landlords here in town, either being discriminated because they have kids, so they won't rent a space to them because they have kids, or being evicted because they complain about the conditions of an apartment or a house. And these clients feel unprotected, and they will probably not come forward to do anything because they fear being deported or what consequences that could have. And that is very sad. Also, like Nathalie was saying, I think representation is really important. So if we are such a diverse town that, you know, hiring practices should be the same, agencies should have people of color, so people, you know, feel encouraged to, you know, study hard, and also they feel more confident seeking these resources. Sometimes people are deterred from looking and seeking these resources because they don't speak the language or because they feel intimidated. But if you see something, someone that looks like you, you might be more willing to go to seek these resources, at least in my opinion. And you know, it's something that the community can work towards, and I'd be happy to see something like that happening in Worthington and Southwest Minnesota in general.
Those are really great issues, and, you know, things to bring up. Thanks, Joyce. We now have a few minutes for audience questions, so please feel free to tap them, type them in the chat. And in case we do go over 8:15, feel free to hop off if you've got to go and enjoy your evening. I just want to thank you all for truly being here with us tonight and listening to such great panelists. We have some questions. Thanks, Matt. What are the greatest legal needs for the immigrant community in Worthington? Whoever wants to take that, Joyce or Justice Moore.
Well, I could take a shot at that one. The needs for the immigrant community are not all that dissimilar from the needs of you know, the regular community. I mean, obviously family law, sometimes criminal law support, civil law, obviously getting representation early in juvenile family matters. Like Joyce said, decisions have to be made regarding eligibility for certain types of opportunities early on, and the quicker that immigrants are aware of those opportunities, the better. I saw needs in housing court occasionally. We didn't have a lot of the cases that some of the Twin Cities courts do, but I would say probably family law areas, custody issues. The unaccompanied minors typically came into court with a what we call a third-party custody action, and where whoever the family members were who the unaccompanied minor had been placed by the immigration authorities in Worthington would need to get that child registered in school, would need to get the authority to make decisions for them. And so they would do that by coming into court with a third, what's called a third-party custody action. And that's where the lawyers are essential. You know, that's not something that these folks are going to be able to figure out by going to a self-help center, or, you know, calling the state law library or something. You really need lawyers on the ground in court in Nobles County that can help those people out. And fortunately, thanks to the Immigrant Law Center, we now have some of those people. In addition to those lawyers, we have other family lawyers in the Worthington community that have done unaccompanied minor cases as well. So the resources from the Immigrant Law Center have helped out private attorneys and helped them be a little bit more aware of some of these immigration issues. Immigrants need criminal support if they are charged with a crime, because being convicted of a crime, if you're an immigrant, can have life-changing consequences. And that's why lawyers in the public defender's office have the ability to reach out to lawyers that are immigration experts that I know the state public defender contracts with to give legal advice to the lawyers on the ground about, you know, why should I maybe not plead guilty to this charge, or what happens if I plead guilty to a lesser charge, and, you know, what options are there for immigrants? And so I'd say those are probably the primary areas, Andrea, but, you know, I in Nobles County, I mean, I had, I think, 20% of my hearings often involved interpreters. And so we saw immigrants in every case type, probate, criminal, juvenile, child protection, the whole gamut.
Thank you. If anyone, does anyone want to add, or?
Another area is, like, I think it was mentioned a little bit, but to bring more attention, is the housing situation. Some children are in need of housing, like, you know, affordable housing, but because of their parent's legal status, they cannot access those services. So that is also very important. You know, when children sleep in unhealthy conditions that affect them, they don't understand what is normal anymore. And there are so many consequences of having a big family of eight in one room, so many consequences that I cannot list here, but it's important to have those services open, at least for parents of children who are born here, or whichever way the decision makers can do. That would be very important to make those services available for families.
That's a great point to add, Nathalie. So thank you for bringing that up. I see a question from John. Well, I'd love to hear some success stories you can share from this time of challenge in Worthington and all of Minnesota. Great uplifting question. If anyone would like to share, feel free to chime in.
Absolutely. We did have a success story during this pandemic. We were able to reunite a family who had been separated for almost 20 years. It was challenging to bring our client back from Guatemala, but after a lot of work, we were able to do it because of, you know, the issue of traveling in a pandemic and the consulate not being very supportive and helpful, but we got to do that. It is hard to bring people from other countries into the U.S. at this time, so that was a big win for the country, but for the family, sorry.
Actually, it is.
And the country, yeah.
Thank you for sharing, Joyce. Anyone would like to share any other story that comes to mind? If not, that's totally okay.
You know, I'm going to throw out a little story that involves several of the people here. And actually, I might throw it over to Kathy to share. Kathy, I'm talking about a lot of people, a lot of naturalization applications that got filed and answered involving Aaron, who is still at our office, and several of the people on here. So Kathy, if you might be able to jump in for a second, it'd be great to hear from you because I know you coordinated that.
Oh, yeah, I'd love to. It's just fun to see prior attorneys on here that staff the office, like Sarah Karki and Aaron and Mallory and Joyce, all who had done an amazing amount of naturalization work. In fact, Aaron, you just like plowed through a whole bunch before you left. And then they kind of got backlogged with immigration and right before the COVID shutdowns, I think we were scheduled for about 35 naturalization interviews in a 3-day period. And so we were arranging a big trip down to Worthington to prep everyone and get them ready. And then COVID came and got shut down. And as soon as they reopened, immigration with full force started scheduling everyone. So it was wonderful to see like people jump in action and all staff, all hands on board, community people giving rides, you know, so that to make sure that the applicants could get up to the cities. They used to go to Sioux Falls. Now they have to come all the way up to Minneapolis for their interviews. And we have, you know, over 40 new citizens out of Worthington that were able to vote in this election. So it's pretty cool. Thanks.
That's so awesome. Thank you, Kathy and Vina, for throwing out Kathy out there to share this wonderful story with us.
Do we have time for another story?
Go ahead, Nathalie.
Yeah, so I have many stories. Let me start with this. Coming to Worthington here, I have learned so many things. I started cooking outdoors. And which is something I've never done in my life, and cooking outdoor. And during COVID also, you know, I turned my business into a business on wheels. You know, it was a new experience. But with that, I was able to reach out to people who could not go to work and could not have food around. So I had curbside drop off for food for people who could not go to the grocery store. I did that through my business, and that was really good. And also another story that happened, thanks to Erin, there was an international student. Usually when we talk about immigrant, we also have people who came here because of family reunification. Some people come here to study. So I had a student who came to study here, and she finished her school. She did law school and public policy, but could not find an opportunity to do her internship. It was a last minute call. I called Erin and she gave her that opportunity to work with her. So that's a great, and that was a miracle for this girl, because if she didn't have it, she had to go and during this go back and with no opportunity, no experience. So she has learned here. And now she's practicing, and this is a great opportunity. Thanks to Erin for that. And thanks to the city for giving the grant, relief grant to small businesses, including everyone. That made a big difference. The city of Worthington did that, and I'm one of the recipients, so I'm very thankful.
Thank you, Nathalie. So many great people that were given shout outs. I know Aaron's on, so thank you for all you've done. And I know there's all the amazing community members on who've done so much work for the immigrant community. So a big, big thank you from myself, and I'm sure from all of us here. If there are no more questions, I will pass it off to Vina.
Thank you all so much. My name is Vina Iyer, and I am proud to be the executive director of the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota. Thank you so much for attending tonight's event. I want to especially thank Matt, Justice Moore, Nathalie, Joyce, and Andrea for sharing your stories tonight, and also for the wonderful ILCM team that put this event together, Kyle, Maggie, Hannah, and Mari. Just One of the things that I committed to in my first year as the executive director of ILCM was to visit each and every one of our offices. And I am really thankful that I made sure to do that in my first quarter as the executive director, because COVID would have prevented me from doing it. But it was just so amazing for me when I got to go down to Worthington with Kathy and just see the town, meet Joyce, get to know a little bit about the town, meet Father Jim and others, and just to see what a vibrant and diverse community it was. I don't think that there's anything that can really tell you about Worthington until you actually go there and really experience the diversity that is that town and the immigrants who make that town the vibrant place that it is today. And we here at ILCM are so thankful to have been part of the Worthington community for the last decade and very much look forward to being in the community for decades more. When I think about Worthington, I think Worthington represents the future of Minnesota and our nation. It's a community that is diverse and is thriving because of its diversity. Over the next year, as many of you know, there will be significant changes to immigration law and policy with a new administration. And we are hopeful that those changes are going to result in an increased need for our services and for the best reasons possible because of the full reinstatement of DACA for Dreamers and hopefully the opening of other pathways to status and citizenship. We are committed to meeting this need at the Immigrant Law Center, but we need your support to do so. So we would ask you to please consider supporting ILCM's work today. The details on how to support ILCM are on this are in the chat. And I want to make sure you know that in celebration of 10 years in Worthington, all of the funds that are going to be raised tonight will go to supporting our work in Southwest Minnesota. Just whenever you go in to click and make a donation, just put, there's a place in your notes and just put Southwest Minnesota or Worthington in the notes. So that's clear. Thank you so much to everybody here for all of your support of our clients, of our community and of ILCM. Over the years. And thank you for joining us and have a wonderful, wonderful night and a wonderful holiday.
Thank you.